Much of the burden of the city's economic development has fallen on its women. Derry's women have built the city. Since its foundation in the middle of the 19th century, the shirt industry has been the backbone of any economic prosperity that Derry has had. And in the days before the welfare state, the women were largely the breadwinners. Older Derry women have memories of beginning work at 12 years of age in a shirt factory, of rearing families in hard times, and of making shirts in their homes when the children had gone to bed. Derry's women have given strength to the character of the city, for they have borne many of its burdens. They have felt the human side of male unemployment, of bad housing, and of the suffering born of emigration of sons and daughters. Someone has said that the history of Derry can be read in the faces of Derry's women, and so it can. For the men, one out of five of them are out of work, tearing the soul from a city, shrouding it in hopelessness, and giving birth to the apathy born of years of idleness and frustration that has been the sickness of Derry down the years. Allied to unemployment, housing is one of Derry's root problems. The key factor in political control in Derry has always been housing and the allocation of housing, and over the years this has been controlled by the party in power. They have used their power to segregate the population on a religious basis, but this has meant that only one area of this city was devoted really to the housing of the larger section of the population. And as the 1960s progressed, this area dried up and houses started to become more and more scarce. Because houses mean votes, and votes mean power. The results were that by 1968, one out of 10 people were without a home. Bad housing is one of the deeper factors in creating the personality of Derry. There's hardly a family in the Catholic districts who have not had to spend the first 6 years of their marriage in poor housing conditions. The psychological effect on children and on their future outlook on life and society in general is something which cannot be measured. The first 4 or 5 years of their lives in which they eat, sleep, and live in cramped conditions has left its mark. Human problems that have affected Derry have always been seen by the majority of its citizens as a result of the political system under which they live. Catholics represent and have always represented 2/3 of Derry's population and have been united politically only in their opposition to the Unionist Party. For normal politics have not been possible in a situation where religion has always been the major political weapon. The 1/3 Unionist minority has always controlled Derry. They need it their Mecca. What they have they hold, and they must always hold the place where their battle was fought. They did so by means of an invidious system now widely known as gerrymander. It was accomplished by a combination of cleverly drawn electoral boundaries, segregated housing, for housing estates are either 90% Catholic or 90% Protestant in Derry, and by an outmoded and undemocratic voting system. In addition, Derry has seen itself as the symbol of all areas opposed to unionism. In recent years, a series of events combined to build up a picture of a new plantation of Ulster, designed to further strengthen unionist areas, areas of existing economic prosperity, to the detriment of Derry's high unemployment. It seemed no coincidence to the people of Derry that the areas of highest unemployment coincided with the areas traditionally opposed to unionism. The closure of the shipping lines from Derry, the severing of one of its rail links, the creation of the new city of Craigavon instead of the existing second city, Derry, the loss of Northern Ireland's second university, all these were seen as part of a plan to further downgrade a city that had already had enough. These factors, combined with the internal problems of Derry, combined to create a combustible situation. A situation seen by the majority of Derry citizens as a cynical political exercise. The pawns of this system of political control were houses and jobs, and its victims were people, generations of men, women and children. A legacy of frustration was building up over the years and was close to the point of explosion. Exploded did on October the 5th, 1968, when a group of young people took to the streets. From now on, the Unionist Party was being met by its own slogans of no surrender and not an inch, for the people of Bogside had had enough. The emergence of the people on the streets and the form of their protest was far removed from the violence that we now see. The people marched under the banner of the civil rights movement and under a policy designed not to replace one domination by another, but to simply achieve equality in the north of Ireland. Unfortunately, the old distrust and the old fears have emerged again. The culmination of last year's activities has been that, ironically, on the anniversary of the first siege of Derry, the second siege, the siege of Bogside, took place. Now the raw elemental forces of history are laid bare, and our community faces its greatest challenge, and the problem has been thrown into the Westminster arena, the place where the final responsibility has always rested. The sights we are witnessing are not new to the north of Ireland. They are a repetition of history. The question is, are the results going to be a repetition as well? Thank you. British troops are on the streets, and British cabinet ministers have at last come to Bogside. But where now? Is the north of Ireland capable of living with justice and equality? Is a state which has lived on and off injustice capable of living with justice? Will the right wing of unionism, will it even agree to justice? For the dispassionate student of the history of Northern Ireland must agree, must clearly admit that the root of the Northern Ireland problem has always been the right wing of unionism. They are the people who have held us in a grip of no change for 50 years. They are the people who still oppose change, and their failure to submit to change leaves a fertile field for anyone who wishes to exploit the situation for any end. Will history repeat itself yet again, this time proving the old saying that historical events begun as a tragedy repeat themselves as a farce? Are we about to witness Carson's forecast of Ulster's last fight? Those are the questions. The answers are less clear, but one thing is certain. We may have new laws, we may have changes in the structure of government, but we must realise that there is no real change without a change in the minds and hearts of the people. Religion must be removed from the field of politics. Prejudice must end, or else. People in the North must live together in peace and justice. For whatever the outcome, we will be side by side for a long, long time. As for Derry, the two traditions must meet. Derry has no future unless there is a change in the minds and hearts of people. For Derry is the mother of us all.